Hello and welcome to the very first episode of my new series, VATSIM Tours, a series which has been requested from you guys throughout a long time. VATSIM Tours will differ from the regular videos that I normally provide by putting the common everyday operation of the 737 into focus. Proper planning and flows, etc. will be discussed thoroughly, especially during this first flight, giving you a better understanding of what goes on behind the scenes. Gradually, as we become more familiar with the routine flows, we'll change the focus towards a more efficient work phase, closing in on the real-world manner of operating this bird. Before we initiate this episode, I must state that I have not finished the VATSIM emergency series yet, and will still provide emergency videos, just as previously. Today we are at Dublin Airport, in a Scandinavian 737-800 airplane, far, far away from home. The goal is to return the plane to Stockholm Arlanda Airport in Sweden at the end of this series. As for now, the plan is to fly small hubs, visiting the UK, maybe the Netherlands, Germany, Denmark, and finally arriving in Sweden. If you're only interested in improving one specific procedure, like the takeoff, descent preparations, engine startup sequence, etc., feel free to head down to the description below where you can find a menu directing you to the desired flow. If you're up for the task of completing all the procedures, well, then good job and let's get started. The very first tour here will be a small hub from Dublin, Ireland to Manchester, England, crossing the Irish Sea, which I'm looking very much forward to do. So without further ado, let's jump straight ahead to the pre-flight planning. Here we have today's dispatch. Our task with this info is to check that everything looks good and that we are comfortable with the weights, weather and route which we have been given. As said, today's flight will be from Dublin to Manchester Airport. The route distance is 158.8 nautical miles, which will take approximately 32 minutes. The first thing we should look at is the fuel planning, but before we'll concern any of the numbers, we should check the remaining amount of fuel at Manchester. Per this plan, we'll arrive with approximately 1.7 tons of fuel, which is a bit below my comfort zone. A rule of thumb is to have at least 2.2 tons remaining at the destination airport. What we'll do is to jump back to the flight plan, replan, and then go to the fuel selector and add another ton to the extra fuel, just like that, and once again we will compute the flight plan. If we now head back to the fuel planning, we see that remaining fuel is 2.7 tons of fuel, which I'm happy with. Now that we have dealt with that, we'll go through the rest of the numbers. During the planned trip, we'll burn 1.5 tons of fuel. To this amount, we must add 5% as required per law. In case of a diversion, we'll route for Liverpool, which is just west of Manchester, adding 511 kilograms, which equals 10 minutes. Final reserve is always 30 minutes for potential hold time at Liverpool. The minimum amount of fuel at takeoff is 3.3 tons. Adding the ton of extra fuel we have requested and the taxi fuel gives us the release of 4.454 tons, meaning that's the amount of fuel we'll request from the fuel truck at the gate. And at last, as discussed, remaining amount of fuel at Manchester is 2.7 tons, which is perfect, and that completes the fuel planning. Now jumping down to the load planning. Empty weight of the 737-800 is almost 43 tons. Payload is 17.8 tons, that includes passengers, bags and cargo, all the things which we get paid for bringing with us on board. Zero fuel weight, a very important figure, is 60.8 tons, and we have a limitation of 61.7 tons, meaning that we are not far from the maximum allowable. The reason why this section exists is to prevent loading up the aircraft with so much payload that even with no fuel on board, the plane is still too heavy for a safe landing. As long as we are below the maximum zero fuel weight of 61.7 tons, we are ensured to have at least 4.5 tons of fuel on board when the gross weight, meaning the total weight of the aircraft, equals the maximum landing weight. Next step is fuel, as discussed, will bring 4.5 tons, which results in a ramp weight of 65.2 tons. Retracting the taxi fuel, and we get the takeoff weight of 65.1 tons, well below the limitation of 78.9. At last, by retracting the trip fuel from the takeoff weight, gives us the estimated landing weight of 63.6 tons, again below the limit of 66.4. If desired, we can bring additionally 921 kilograms of payload before we hit the maximum zero fuel weight. If we for any reason want to add more fuel, we can carry another 2,792 kilograms before we are limited by the landing weight. And that completes the weights. Now moving on to the weather, selecting the weather tab. Origin is Dublin International, Echo India Delta Whiskey, the 27th time 2013 Zulu, winds 230 at 4 knots.
If you're up for the task,
visibility is clear.
If you're
clouds
up for the
few at 1,700 feet, broken flight level 100. Temperature is 6 degrees. Dew point is 4. Qnate 1003. No significant. Destination Manchester. Echo Golf Charlie Charlie 27th 2020 Zulu. Automated service. Winds 140 at 7 knots. Variable between 100 and 170. Visibility 7 kilometers. Clouds overcast 1,100 feet. Temperature 4. Dew point 2. Qnate 1007. Temporary scattered 1,100 feet. So, airport's weather has been checked. Moving on to checking the in-flight weather. Today's cruise altitude will be flight level 230, so we'll just open the weather tab, selecting wind and turbulence information. At flight level 250, we have a bit turbulence north of the route, but not at our concern during today's flight. Checking flight level 200, we have a small band south of the route, again, nothing to worry about. Checking at our specific cruise altitude of flight level 230, looks completely clear. Winds coming from the south at approximately 55 knots, determined by the tails of the arrows. So we'll just check the weather during the climb and the descent, checking flight level 150, all clear, flight level 100, clear as well, and finally flight level 050, everything clear. Weather have been checked, nothing too major to be concerned about, apart from the very low temperatures combined with the cloud layers, which could cause some icing conditions. Moving on to the last step of the pre-flight planning, which is the route. Departure out of Dublin will probably not be the Kisha 1 Bravo as the dispatch tells us, because this departure is meant for airplanes of the category A and B. The Boeing 737-800 falls under the category C, which is why I'll expect the Liffey 5 Alpha for departure instead. From Liffey, we'll join the Unifor Lima 975 airway to Linus, where we'll join the arrival route, Mercy 1 Bravo, into Manchester. And there we have it, route have been checked, which completes the pre-flight preparations, and we should now be very well suited for today's flight. See you in the cockpit. So, here we are in the cold and dark state of the Boeing 737, a state which you normally do not meet, as the aircraft mostly is handed off by another crew, which have just arrived at the gate. In that case, the cockpit will be in a so-called return state, meaning that almost everything has been left running except the engines. But enough of that, let's get this bird powered up so we can get out of here. Because all electricity to the plane has been cut, we must initiate with the electronic power-up flow, which starts at the overhead panel. The Boeing 737 is powered by two types of electricity, DC and AC power. DC power is provided by the battery, and feeds the aircraft with the most essential controls in the case that AC power is lost. AC power is drawn from either the engine's generator or the APU's generator, meaning that at least one of these three must be running to provide the airplane with AC power. The first thing we'll do is to turn on the battery switch and cap it, feeding the plane with DC power and waking some of the instruments to life. In the electrical panel, we can now observe the battery's voltage at 28. Which is perfect, and its amps, which is minus 37. Negative amps signify that the battery is being discharged, which is to be expected at this time, and totally normal indications. Before we'll feed the plane with AC power, we must ensure certain switches are in the correct position, to avoid something suddenly moves once AC power is attached. Starting off by checking all the fuel pumps is in the off position. The two electrical driven hydraulic pumps, the trimmer, both recirculation fans and both packs should all be off. Jumping down to check that the gear is indicating three green lights and levers in down descent position. Parking brake should be set, engine start levers both in cutoff, and checking the fire warning panel. All three levers brightens and the engine 1 and 2 overheat lights illuminate. After all these switches have been checked, we may connect the AC power, which can be done in one of two ways. We can either power up the APU, which can be done from DC power alone, or we could connect the ground power card. Normal procedure is to obtain the AC power from the ground card, because it's much cheaper and quieter than running the APU. So we'll jump down to the first officer's CDU, flight simulator actions, and whilst we're at it, we can load up the aircraft's fuel and payload. Grabbing the flight plan, checking the fuel planning, release was 4,457 kilograms of fuel. payload. We have a zero fuel weight of 60.8 tons, which we can just enter, and it will figure out how to distribute itself. Ground connections, I'll connect the ground power and the air conditioning unit. And finally, we'll just open all the doors, both forward and aft, left and right entries, and the cargo hatches. Requesting catering service to initiate. If we once again have a look on the overhead panel, we see that the ground power available light has illuminated. By flicking the ground power button, we allow the aircraft to draw power from this source, and as we see, all the instruments, lighting, etc. have turned on. The first thing I'll do is just to turn on some lighting for you guys. Next step is to arm the emergency lights, but only do this once AC power has been connected, because the emergency lights is programmed to automatically turn on in the event that AC power is lost or disconnected. Moving up to the aft overhead panel, powering the irises, as they take quite some time to fully align, and we therefore want to initiate this process as fast as possible. If we scroll the display switch to show the status, we see the alignment time is 8 minutes to be. Jumping all the way down to check the oxygen flow is good. The yellow cross should come visible once we press the test button, looks good. And by pressing the red button, we should have continual flow. Seems good. Continuing down to the left CDU, checking the item page. Model is the 737-800 with winglets. Engine rating is 26,000. Nav data is within the active cycle. Everything is correct, so we'll continue with the position initialization page. Entering our current position of Dublin, Echo India Delta Whiskey, and we are at gate 208. Scrolling to the next page to pick up the GPS located position, which should come shortly. There we have them. Coming one of them to the scratch pad, scrolling back, and we'll just cross check that the coordinates we entered and the GPS coordinates are more or less the same. Perfect. Passing it in full right. The rest we'll cover once we have obtained our clearance. And that completes the electrical power up flow, and we now have the plane in the return state, as mentioned previously. The next flow we'll initiate is the so-called waterfall flow, starting at the very aft overhead and flows all the way down to the pedestal. The first thing we'll check here is the leading edge flaps indicators. All lights should illuminate here. IRS display switch will scroll to the test position. Looks good, and back to status. Remaining time is 7 for the left IRS and 7 for the right as well. Service interphone should be in the off position. Engine 1 and 2 reverse lights should be extinguished. EEC should both indicate on and not alternative. And the engine control light should be extinguished. Crew oxygen at approximately 1600 psi, which is sufficient. Passenger oxygen mask is kept normal, lights off. Flight recorder will just uncap this, flicking the switch to the test, and light extinguishes. Good. Overspeed warning 1 and 2, both good. Stall warning 1, sounds good, and number 2 is not sounding. Nothing to be worried about here, this is totally normal indication. And it's usually caused because the hydraulic system are unpressurized, causing gravity to extend the leading edge flaps. And if these flaps are extended with a symmetry, the stall warning gets disabled. Moving on to the backup gear indicators, showing 3 green and PSEU light is out, making sure that no proximity switches disagree with oneself. Perfect. Moving down to the overhead panel. Flight control switches A and B should be kept. Same goes for the spoiler A and B. All lights are out. Alternative flaps kept and wired, making sure that it has not been accessed. If it had, maintenance must be advised because the action is irreversible from the cockpit. Yaw damper goes on. Navigation panel, all sources are in normal and display switches are in auto and normal. Engine valve and spar valve on both sides, closed. Checking the operation of the crossfeed valve. Bright blue indicates the valve is in transit and dark blue indicates the valve is open. Bright blue, transit, and light extinguished, meaning the valve is closed. All fuel pumps, once again, off. Moving up to the next pillar, the electrical panel will initiate by checking the DC power, and GGX just requests us to close the right doors, so I'll just do that by using my shortcuts, like that. Standby power indicates 26 volts, good. Battery bus 26 volts, battery 28, auxiliary battery 28, good. transfer rectifiers, which transfer the 150 volts AC power to 26 volts DC power, charging and powering the DC systems, indicates 26 volts and positive amps. Transfer rectifier 2, 26 volts, 22 amps, and TR3, 26 volts and 30 amps, leaving it at test. Moving on to the AC meter, here we must check both voltage and frequency. Normal indications are 150 volts and a frequency of 400. Standby power has a frequency of 402 and a voltage of 115, totally acceptable. Ground power is 402 and 115, positive amps indicates that we are drawing power from this source. Both engines and the APU are all off, which is why the generator says zero. Inverter is 400 and 117 volts, perfect. Selecting test here as well, and we'll press the maintenance test button, which will check the system for any faults. Just moving its way through all meters, and no faults stored, good indication, and we can now turn on the electricity to the cabin and the in-flight entertainment system. Crossing over to the next pillar, equipment cooling should be in normal, and the lights below should be extinguished. GSX has completed the catering service, that's lovely. To check the emergency lights again, seatbelt signs can come on. Moving up to the window heat section, we'll just flick on all the heaters, make an overheat test. Looks good. Flipping all the switches to off and then on again. Probeat, we'll just make sure that all these works. Seems good. And leaving them off for now, so they don't overheat whilst the plane is stationary due to the lack of wind flow countering the heating. Skipping the anti-ice switches as they don't respond without pressure from the bleed air system. Hydraulic panel, if no maintenance is around working on the plane, we can pressurize the hydraulic system B. For now we'll make sure that the A system is unpressurized, because the A system controls the nose wheel steering. During the pushback, the tow truck needs to turn the nose wheel, which it would be unable to do if the A system was pressurized. Therefore we'll turn off both the engine and electrical driven pumps for the A system, and both on for the B system. Door indicators, we have the forward and aft left entries open and both the cargo hatches. Cockpit voice recorder, holding down the green button for 5 seconds, green light should appear, deleting that test. Pressurization dial, differential is 0, cabin altitude is more or less at 0 as well, and the cabin climb rate is at 0. Trim is off and air conditioning switches are all in auto. Recirculation fans are off for now because the ground air card takes care of the circulation. Packs are off, isolation valve open, and the APU bleed air is off. Pressurization panel, all lights out, grabbing the flight plan once again. Cruise altitude was flight level 230. Airport altitude at Manchester is 257 feet above sea level. 250 feet is set, which is perfect. Checking the alternative, light illuminate, and manual, and back to auto. All exterior lighting should be off except the positioning. Starters are in the off position, and lift igniter will be used for today's start. This switch is being alternated every flight, meaning the next time we'll start the engines, we'll use the right igniter. APU is off and rest of the lights is off. So, before we'll continue the waterfall flow, we'll just pick up our clearance, but first we must get the latest weather information. Dublin ATIS is on frequency 124.520, and we'll flick it to the active.
This is Dublin information, Delta. At time 2100, expect ILS approach, runway 28, in use, transition level 65, wind 210 degrees 4 knots, visibility 10 kilometers, clouds few 1,700 feet, broken 10,000 feet, temperature 6.4 Q and H. 1003 06. Advise on a NIC contact. You have information Delta.
Good, we have information Delta on board, and we can now contact tower on frequency 118.600. Dublin Tower, good evening. Scandinavian 619 requesting radio check.
Scandinavian 619 Tower, hello, readability is 505.
Scandinavian 619, thanks. We are parked at gate 208 in a Boeing 737-800 with information Delta on board. Requesting IFR clearance to Manchester.
Scandinavian 619, clear to Manchester. Reefy 5 Alpha, squawk 6600, frequency after departure, Dublin approach, on 121.1.
clear to Manchester via the Leafy 5 after departure, squawking 6600 after departure contacting Dublin approach on 11.100, Scandinavian 619.
Scandinavian 619, back is correct. Calling ready for question starting.
We'll go, Scandinavian 619. Perfect, we'll initiate the boarding, letting all passengers on board, and moving down to program the CDU. As the rule was exported from PFPX, we can request it from the name Echo India Delta Whiskey Echo Golf Charlie Charlie 01. Selecting company route, and it should now be entered in the route. We see direct to Liffey joining the Unifor Lima 975 airway to Linus and arriving by the Mercy 1 Bravo Bravo. That's correct. Programming the departure route, active runway was 28 and the assigned departure was Liffey 5 of. Jumping back to route, now having the complete plan, which we will just briefly check. Selecting the plan mode at the EFIS panel, grabbing both the ND and CDU, going to the legs page, and we'll just go through all the waypoints, just checking for any discontinuities or other strange occurrences, setting the bigger radius so we see the airport. Oh, here it is in the right direction. Now that the route seems legit, we activate it and move on to the performance initialization page. Zero fuel weight was 60.7, reserve fuel will just set that to 2.2 tons today, cost index will be 30, cruise altitude was 5230, and transition altitude, we can just find that on the departure chart, is 6000. Perfect. Moving on to the N1 limit. We'll now bring up TopCat, the takeoff and landing performance calculation tool. Aircraft is the Boeing 737-800, everything should be set up correctly, so we'll move on to the takeoff tab. Airport is Dublin, runway will be 28. We'll just update the conditions. Winds is 230 at 4, temperature 6 degrees, Grenade 1003, runway condition is dry. That checks. Takeoff weight is 65.1 tons per the plan. Flaps and thrust configurations are in optimum. Air condition will be on and NTIs will probably be on the engine cowls. Computing the figures, and we'll check the high SD rate of 31 degrees. Which has a margin of 466 meters, meaning that's the distance we will have left if we abort at V1. For this takeoff, we will use flaps 1, takeoff configuration 1, and the minimum N1 is 88.8. Good. Jumping back in the cockpit, config was the 1, temperature is 31 degrees, N1 is 89.6, which is above the required of 88.8. Flaps was 1, and we request the trim being 5.09. V-speeds, we have a V1 144, VR of 145, and V2 152. We just set the V2 in the MCP. Continuing to the progress page to check the remaining amount of fuel at Manchester is 3 tons, that's good. Everything is covered and we'll go to the legs page and scroll the ND to the map mode. Continuing the waterfall flow from the EFIS panel, putting the barometer to hectopascal and setting it to 1003. ND is in plan mode, pushing down the right knob to activate the traffic feature, showing all the planes we encountered during the flight, and selecting the terrain features as well, which is useful during departure and arrival. Range can come down to 10 or even 5 nautical miles. Moving on to the MCP, both flight directions to on, making sure ours go on first so we get the master. All throttle can come on, otherwise this can wait till we taxi. Gear down indicating 3 green, flaps indicating up, auto brake system goes to RGO, arming it for a potential rejected takeoff, and we'll just do a quick self-test, which it has passed when the light extinguishes. Fuel flow, moving that to reset so we know how much fuel each engine have used. Speed reference in auto, N1 set in auto as well. Light test is optional, for the sake of this video we'll just do a very fast check going through all the lights. Overhead is good, and pedestal is good as well. Checking the autopilot annunciation lights, nose wheel steering kept in normal, perfect. Moving a bit down, checking the primary flight display and the navigation display. MCP speed indicates the V2 speed of 142, V1 is indicated 144. Speed tape showing default value of 45 knots, because the pilot cannot measure precisely at lower speeds. Ground speed, which is determined by GPS, indicates 0. Radar altitude showing minus 4 feet. Assess that because we land with a nose up attitude, having the nose approximately 4 feet higher than the main gears. At touchdown on the main gear, it will therefore indicate 0 feet. Altitude is level and 0 degrees following the flight director. Altimeter is showing approximately 250 feet above sea level, which checks with the airport elevation. Vertical speed is 0 and heading is 013. Moving to the ND, which has the same heading. Perfect. Passenger boarding has been completed. Baggage is still in progress. Moving down to the multifunctional display to check the oil quantity of the engines. It is 99 and 98%. That's perfect. Boarding has been completed, so we'll just close the remaining doors. Moving down to the throttle quadrant, setting the trim at approximately 5.1. Speed brakes are in the down detent, flaps is up, throttle is closed, park brake is set, and engine start levers are in cutoff. Stabilized trim switches are kept in normal. Moving down to the pedestal, checking the fire warning once again. After that we have connected AC power, we should now see the rear wheel fire warning system, which we knew. Testing the cargo fire. Good. Transponder, making sure it's on expander 1 and source 1. Entering the squawk code of 6600. Pressing the test button, and we'll move up to see the indications in the PFD and ND. We have the attitude indicators, the vertical speeds, and in the ND we see the four different types of threats.
TCAS test, pass.
We are good to go. Checking the rudder trim to see if we can move it. First a notch to the left, and then to the right, and back to neutral. Ailerons are centered, stabilizer trim is in normal, and flight deck door is in auto, no lights. Moving to the ground proximity panel, all three inhibits features should be in normal and kept. Making a full test of the ground proximity warning system by holding down the button for at least 5 seconds. It will now go through all the different warning systems which are installed, which takes approximately 1.5 minutes, so we'll just skip the waiting.
Wind shear. Wind shear.
Terrain. Terrain.
Pull up.
And there we go, that was the last item on the waterfall flow. Indeed, a very long flow, but also very important, because we must know the state of the aircraft to the very least detail. Hope everyone still follows along, as the hardest part now have been completed, and we are now ready to execute the pre-flight checklist. Oxygen tested 100%. Navigation transfer and display switches is in normal and auto. Window heat is on. Pressurization mode selector is in auto, no lights. Flight instruments, we have a heading of 013, and we'll just check the standby compass. Indicates more or less 013 as well. Altimeter is set 1003. Park brake is set. Engine side levers are in the cutoff position. Pre-flight checklist complete. Now that we've covered that, we can take a short break until we close in on the departure time. The next step is namely the before start flow, where we'll fire up the APU and become self-energized, and not require any external sources. So, the first thing we'll do is to fire up the APU. The APU is connected to the left tank, which is why I will turn on one of the two left pumps. Holding the APU switch in start for 1 second, and it will initiate the power-up sequence, which is fully automatical. If any failures or abnormalities are detected, it would automatically cut the fuel supply and shut down. This means that we can do other things while the APU is powering up, like going through the departure briefing. Today's flight is from Dublin, Ireland to Manchester, UK. We are parked at the gate 208, which for some reason is titled 15 Tango on my chart. Pushback will be to the left. Expected taxi route will be via Link 3, Foxtrot 2, Foxtrot 1 to Echo 1 holding short runway 28. Departure runway is 28, which has a heading of 281 degrees. We'll use the entire runway length of 2,637 meters and I will be the pilot flying. Prior to 80 knots, we'll stop for any problems. Between 80 knots and V1, we'll only stop for an onboard fire, engine failure, or anything I consider might hinder the airworthiness of the plane. Above V1, we are committed to flight and we will deal with the problem in the air. Today we are below the maximum landing weight and we can therefore land immediately after takeoff if necessary. From runway 28, we'll join the departure sit, Levy 5 Alpha, which is the straight out to the NDB Oscar Echo, crossing it at or above 3000 feet. Thereafter we will make a right turn to intercept Dublin VOR inbound on a radial of 096 degrees, crossing the VOR continuing outbound on the same radial to Liffey. In proportion to obstacles, we have something just after the end of the runway at 408 feet. Otherwise, if we take a look at the minimum sector altitude, we should be clear above 2200 feet as we depart east of Dublin VOR. Reading through the notes, we must follow a climb gradient of 9.1%, which won't be any problem with the load we are carrying today. Maximum indicated airspeed is 250 below theta 100. For Livy 5 Alpha, we have a max indicated airspeed of 290 above level 100 as well. Integrity check fix available from radar. Warning, climb to flight 090. Do not climb above flight 090 until instructed by ATC. So, initial cleared altitude is flight 090. Continuous climb to 4000 feet required on that doesn't concern us. And number 7, do not concern us either. Number 8, immediately after takeoff, contact Dublin, blah blah blah, as appropriate. Number 9, DME or GNSS navigation is required. We have both. And that wraps up the departure briefing. So let's jump back in the cockpit and set the runway heading of 281 degrees in the MCP. And initial cleared altitude to 9000. Another thing we can also do real quick is just to insert the arrival route. Emergency 1 Bravo, so we don't have to struggle with that once we are in the air. But today's flight is relatively short. Just checking that the correct waypoints for the arrival has been entered. Linus to Mellot crossing at flight 170 to Wellesley VOR. Arriving at Mercy. Seems good, so we'll execute it. Jumping to the overhead, APU-GN available light has illuminated. Checking the electrical panel to see if the APU provides good electricity. Frequency is 402, volts are 115, and we are drawing 51 amps from the source. If we look at the ground power, we still see the current and the frequency because the card is still connected, but it indicates no amps because we do not draw any power from this plant any longer. So we can now jump to the CDU and disconnect the GPU and ACU by removing the chucks, good, and the lights are still on, which is always a good indication. Now that the air conditioning unit has been disconnected, the air is no longer circulated in the cabin, which is why we'll turn on the recirculation fans, as we spoke about earlier. Okay, we are almost set to go, only one thing remaining, which is to check the bleed air. Setting the isolation valve to auto and APU bleed to on. We see that duct pressure is now rising, which is a good indication, so we are ready for the push. Scandinavian 619 from gate 208, ready for pushback.
Scandinavian 619, your push is as approved, QNH1003.
Stun push approved, QNH1003, Scandinavian 619. Okay, requesting ground service to push. Nose goes to left, and we'll start the engine while pushing. Flicking all the fuel pumps to on, center tank is empty, anti-collision light to on, and we are ready to execute the before start checklist. Flight deck doors are closed and locked, fuel is 4400 kilograms, pumps is all on, passenger signs is on, and windows are locked. MCP, we have a V2 speed of 152, heading of 281, and initial cleared altitude is 9000. V-speeds, we'll just go find them in the CDU. We have a V1 of 144, VR 145, and a V2 of 152. CDU preflight has been completed, run and aileron trim 3 and 0. Taxi and takeoff briefing has been completed, anti-collision light is on. Before start checklist complete. Releasing the parking brakes, starting the timer, and we have permission for engine start. So once again, we'll just quickly check the duct pressure, it looks good. Selecting number 2 igniter to ground. We'll just bring up the ED and MFD. Engine 2, we have a start valve open. And we see the enter rotation is rising. This is due to the bleed air, which is blown through the turbine. Awaiting the N2 rotation to reach 25%, where we'll set the engine start levers to idle, allowing the fuel to enter. 25%, which goes to idle, and we'll now monitor the fuel flow. We have a rise, and EGT rises as well. Oil pressure is rising, low oil pressure light should extinguish in a second. There we go. N1 is rising, EGT is rising, also looking for a hot start here on the EGT display. If it exceeds the red line, we must immediately cut the fuel. N2 is rising, fuel flow stabilizes, oil pressure rising along with the oil temperature, quantity looks good, and vibration indicates 0. When the N2 reaches 56%, the starter valve should close. And we see the light extinguishes, perfect, awaiting the EGT to make a rollback and stabilize. There we go, EGT decreases, good start on number 2. Setting the parking brakes and repeating the same procedure with the number 1 engine. Stars goes to ground, getting the displays. star belt is open. We see into rotation. Again, at 25% N2, we'll flick the engine lever to idle. Slight rise in the oil pressure as well as N1, that's good. There we go, watching the fuel flow. And EGT rise. Oil pressure rises normally. Light extinguishes. N1 is good. EGT is good. N2 is good. Fuel flow stable. Pressure and temperature rising. Quincy good. And vibration is 0. Just scanning the indicators. Just waiting 56% N2 for the start valve to close. And we hear this little click. And light extinguishes. EGT, just making sure it doesn't keep rising. Here we have the decrease. Good start on number one as well. Jumping to the overhead panel, switching the electricity source to the engine generators. Checking the electrical panel. Gen 1 has a frequency of 400 volts at 115 amps 53. Spot on. Engine 2, frequency 400 volts, 150 and amps 44. Perfect as well. Probe heat can come on now as we will soon be moving. Anti-ice will use on the engines due to the low temperatures combined with the precipitation in shape of clouds. Ground crew has disconnected the tow and we have received the hand signal, so hydraulic system A can now be pressurized. Trim air goes to on, both pack and auto, and APU bleed off. For external lighting we will use the wing and logo light. Both starters goes to continuous, so if an engine stops it would automatically try to restart, which is vital in a critical situation like during takeoff and landings. APU can come off, recall is clear, checking the hydraulic condition in the MFD, quantity is 198%, pressure approximately 3000 psi, perfect. Doing a flight control check, going full left, neutral, full right, and neutral. Elevators full aft, neutral, full forward, and neutral. Rudder full left, neutral, full right, and neutral. Good check on that, setting flaps for takeoff, and we'll complete the before taxi checklist. Generators are on and takes a load. Probe heat is on, anti-ice is on the engines, isolation valve in auto. Engine start switches are both in continuous. Recall has been checked. Auto brake is in RGO, no light. Engine start levers are in the idle detent. Flight controls have been checked. Ground equipment is clear. Hand signal is received. Left and right are clear. Before taxi checklist has been completed. Scandinavian 619, we are ready for the taxi.
Scandinavian 619, taxi link 3, left Foxtrot, Echo 1, hold from way to way.
Taxi link 3, left on Foxtrot, holding short, Echo 1, runway 28, Scandinavian 619. Okay, perfect, we'll just follow the expected route, which we briefed earlier. Releasing the parking brakes, slight increase in thrust, and we'll turn on the taxi lights. Taxi speed is a maximum of 20 knots, but now that we're close to the gate, we will take a bit more care. For situational awareness, we'll just bring up the ground chart, so you guys can follow along. So, in a moment, we'll make this kind of zigzag, first left, then a right through link 3. Trying to manage the speed. Follow the line whilst looking the way we're going. And then turning right here. And we see link 3 on the tarmac. Just watching for traffic before we turn left onto Foxtrot. Right is clear and left is clear. Currently at Foxtrot 2, which means that we are closing in on the runway and will therefore begin the before takeoff flow. Today we'll depart via VNAV and LNAV. so engaging those. A good indication that we have programmed the CDU correctly are if these activate. Once again, we'll make a zigzag kind of drive here to join Foxtrot 1, just tapping the brakes real quick to slow down, avoiding turning too rapidly, which there are two good reasons why not to do. Firstly, for passengers' comfort, so they don't get thrown around in the back. And second, which most likely is the main course, is that the nose wheel undergoes pretty massive forces when we turn, because the plane wants to continue forward, and the nose wheel tries to change this direction. But back to the flow, checking the packs are in auto and that we have dock pressure. Trim is set around 5.1, which is within the green takeoff band.
Scandinavian 619, wind calm, runway 28, clear for takeoff, bye-bye.
Runway 28, cleared for takeoff, Scandinavian 619. So we'll continue out on the runway, executing the runway entry procedure. Landing lights, runway turnoffs, and strobe all to on. Just checking the final before proceeding onto the runway, seems clear to me. And right is clear as well. And the next step is the transponder. Setting that to TARA. Lining up with the runway, and I'll just set squawk mode Charlie and B-pilot as well, as it isn't always synced with the aircraft transponder. Okay, that was the runway entry procedure, moving on to the before takeoff flow, flap indicating 5, which they should not, real quick change the setting to flaps 1. Even though this probably wouldn't have been the biggest problem, it clarifies how important it is to check these things multiple times, because we are humans and we do make mistakes. It's just about catching those mistakes before it's too late. Okay, good, that completes the before takeoff flow, and we'll now execute the checklist. Before takeoff checklist, flap now set 1, green light. Stabilize trim, set 5.1. Before takeoff checklist complete. Okay, we are good to go. Okay, here we go, takeoff. I have control. Advancing thrust to 40% N1. Engine spoil up. Thrust is stable, toga. Moving the throttles along, keeping my hand on them. Slight forward pressure on the yoke. Takeoff thrust is set as the N1 percentage is stable and correspond to the calculated values which are shown above. 80 knots checked, thrust hold, seen in the FMA, and we are now capable to override the auto throttle if we wish to abort. Everything seems normal. Here comes V1. Removes hand from throttle. Gently back pressure on the yoke. Pitching for 12 degrees, not exceeding 15 degrees to avoid tail strike. Posterior right, gear up. Now I'm pitching for V2 speed. Here we go, 400 feet, pitching slightly down to reach the V2 plus 20 knots. V2 plus 20 knots is the white dot shown at the speed tape. Keeping this at 2 to 1500 feet AGL, where we'll further lower the nose and begin the flap retraction sequence. Here comes 1500 feet rate altitude, engine goes to climb thrust, and speed bug moves to flaps up maneuvering speed. Flap 1 speed, flaps go to up, and as we were concentrating on the takeoff, I forgot everything about contacting departure, so we'll just do that real quick. Departure frequency has been entered in the standby, so we'll just flick it to the active. Dublin approach, good evening, Scandinavian 619 with you on the departure route, Liffey 5 Alpha, climbing through 3,900 feet.
Scandinavian 619, our radar identified. Continue your climb, you're cleared to cruise altitude, flight level 230.
Continue climb, flight level 230, Scandinavian 619, thanks. So we'll just concentrate on doing this turn before achieving the MCP altitude. Remember, flying the plane is always the main task. So we are stable in altitude, and we can now change the MCP to flight level 237. Okay, after takeoff checklist, engine bleeds are on, packs are in auto, landing gear is up, now go to off, flaps up, no light, auto brake can come off as well. After takeoff checklist complete. Terrain feature can now go off, turning on the weather radar instead, warning us against any thunderstorm and such, coming through transition altitude, setting the barometer to standard. Autopilot is in command, climbing through 10,000 feet, landing lights, runway turning off, and starters, taxi lights, all goes to off. Logo and wing light can come off as well, notifying the attendants that they can now begin their services. Checking the pressurization dial, making sure the cabin pressurizes properly. At 10,000 feet, the cabin altitude would normally indicate around 1,000 feet, and the differential pressure 4 psi. Seems perfect today. Both packs are still in auto and we have adequate duct pressure and bleeds are on the engines. Temperatures, we can just take a quick look at the temperatures in the forward cabin. It's around 22 degrees, that's perfect, and aft cabin the same. 10,000 feet flow has been completed. And we must remember we had a speed restriction of 270 knots above flight level 100 during the departure. What we'll do is just to make a speed intervention and make it pitch for 270 knots until we leave Liffey, being the last waypoint on the departure set. In the top right corner of the ND, we see the distance to Liffey being 26 nautical miles. Beautiful as we come through the clouds, dark blue skies, very nice and soft cloud layer. It doesn't get much prettier. But enough of that, in the ND we see a small arc of green dots. The way the weather radar functions is to send out impulses and display areas with big density of something that is not air, or so to speak. This could be thunderstorms as they carry a lot of water, or just some small grouping of precipitation with them. So what I'm trying to say here is, as long as the dots are this size, we should not concern too much about it. It's only if we see a massive coherent blip on the radar, we know for sure it's a thunderstorm or any other kind of weather we would like to avoid. Okay, now that everything runs smoothly all by itself, we have surplus to monitor the fuel burning to see if we stay on the schedule. At Dublin VOR we had 3.8 tons, scheduled set 4.0 tons, that's okay. At Liffey we're expecting to have 3.3 tons of fuel, fuel planning says 3.5 tons, so we're actually 0.2 tons behind fuel schedule. But it seems like we'll catch up with that number once we arrive at Manchester. Arriving fuel at Manchester is predicted by the FMC to be 2.8 tons. According to the schedule it should be 2.8 tons as well. That's just perfect. Okay, we are free of the clouds now and the air seems smooth, so we can release the passengers from their seats. Anti-ice can come off as well, now that we are free of precipitation weather. Even though temperatures are well below freezing, we are safe because there is no water molecules to freeze on the wings or engines. In order to require anti-ice, we must have a combination of temperatures below 10 degrees Celsius and precipitation weather. If just one of those aren't present, anti-ice is not needed. Also, we put the seatbelt signs in the auto position and not off, so that they will automatically turn on below 10,000 feet if we were to forget them during the descent. Coming in on the cruising altitude, as well as Liffey, which means we are about to leave the departure route along with its restrictions. Deactivating the speed intervene, giving the FMC full control of the speed again. In the FMA, we see FMC speed and VNAV. The FMC speed was because we gave the FMC the speed control back, and VNAV path because we are now at the cruise altitude and will now stay at the cruising altitude entering the CDU. TCAS has observed another plane to our left, but way above us, so no worries there. Again we see a band of green dots which have become a bit clearer. It's probably just a small string of turbulent clouds, I don't know, but we'll keep an eye on it and potentially turn on the seatbelt signs once we penetrate it.
Scandinavian 619 are now leaving the Dublin control zone. However, at now onward ATC, proceed as fire zone navigation. Monitor Unicom 122.8. Good night.
Roger, Will, Manager Unicom, 122.8, thank you for the services, Scandinavian 619, good night. Okay, we are now all by ourselves, but luckily Manchester arrival is online, and we will be contacting him when we get a bit closer. But good job, and thanks to everyone who still follows along, we have now made it to the cruising phase, but we'll soon begin our descent preparation. Just real quickly, if you have enjoyed so far, and hopefully learned a thing or two along the way, please be so kind to leave a like, it's very much appreciated. Or if you desire, leave a comment below. Feel free to ask any questions you may have at this point in time, and I'll do my very best to answer. Also, if you don't want to miss out on further tours, where we will change the focus towards a more efficient and professional manner of operating this bird, be sure to hit that subscribe button. And of course, if you haven't already, I highly suggest you guys to check out my emergency videos, performed on the VATSIM Network as well. Links will be in the description below. But let's jump back in the cockpit. A good rule of thumb is to initiate the descent preparation approximately 100 nautical miles prior to the top of the descent. As said earlier, today's flight is indeed very short, so we are already way closer to the top of the descent, as we see in the ND. But no worries, that was exactly why we chose to do some of the descent preparations even before we left the ground, like entering and checking the arrival route. First item on the descent preparation list is to obtain the destination airport's weather information. Manchester ATIS is on frequency 121.97. Because we still must monitor Unicom meanwhile, we'll use the first officer's radio, dialing in the frequency of 121.70, like that, and we'll activate the VHF2 on my panel. Okay, we now have information pub on board and we'll initiate the arrival briefing. Today we'll arrive at Manchester, expecting the ILS runway 23 right. We'll face a minor crosswind at 6 knots, which should not bother us too much. During landing we'll use anti-ice on the engines due to the several layers of clouds and temperatures below 10 degrees. Visibility is clear and we'll expect a wet runway as it is raining. As mentioned several times now, the arrival into Manchester is the Mercury 1 Bravo, which we have already programmed in CDU. We'll arrive via Unifor Lima 975 west to Linus, continuing towards Wellesley VOR on a radial of 277 degrees to Mullet and then to the VOR itself. At Wellesley VOR, we'll turn left onto outbound radial of 062 degrees to Mercy. Altitude guidelines, and hear me correct here, guidelines being what we may expect from ATC, but not actual cleared altitudes. Altitude restrictions and permissions are always given from ATC unless other is specified. But we can expect to cross Liffey at flight level 270, which we won't do today because we are cruising at flight level 230. Additionally, we'll expect to cross Mallard at flight level 170, which have been programmed in the CDU. Transition altitude is 5,000 feet and area minimum altitude is 4,600 feet. For situational awareness, we'll just have a visual look at the arrival as well. We'll be coming from the west, crossing Linus, continuing east to Mullet, then Wellesley VOR, turn left, northeast to Mercy. Warning, do not proceed beyond Mercy without ATC clearance. Next box, number 1, do not exceed 230 knots indicated airspeed at Mercy. Number 2, clearance limit Mercy unless otherwise instructed by ATC. Descent planning ATC requirements, I won't bother you with reading through that. What it pretty much says is just what I mentioned earlier. Actual descent clearance will be as directed by ATC and not per this chart. Jumping down to the general information. Number 1, these procedures also apply for aircraft inbound to Woodford. Number 2, cross LSPs or 3 minutes before holding facility at 250 knots indicated airspeed or less when at flight level 140 or below. The SLP for us is when we cross Wellesley, so we make sure to be at 250 knots or below when crossing. Number 3, when Pole Hill VOR or DME is out of service, Mercy holding axis is aligned to the Wellesley VOR radial 062 between 12 and 17 nautical miles. Okay, that's all good. Grabbing the ILS chart for runway 23 right. Starting at the very top, highest minimum sector altitude around Manchester VOR is 3,500 feet MSL. Frequencies we will not mind. Aerodrome elevation is 257 feet. Pressurization panel is set to a landing altitude of 250 feet. Perfect. The ILS has a frequency of 109.5 and the identifier is India November November. It is a straight in approach on heading 233. We'll capture the glide path at 3,500 feet, 10 dme from the localizer. Decision altitude is at 331 feet MSL or 82 feet AGL. If we have to go around, we'll climb to 3,500 feet, straight ahead until passing 750 feet or localizer DME 0, whichever is later. Then turn right onto track 358 degrees, then as directed. Once again, we'll just get a visual reference from the map, take the right after the ILS localizer onto track 358. Perfect. Jumping down to the notes. Number 1. In the event of radio communication failure, follow the standard missed approach procedure onto track 358 degrees. At Manchester VOR DME 10, turn direct to Burnie, climbing to 5,000 feet to enter the Rosin hold. Aircraft unable to make 3,500 before Manchester DME 10, commence climbing, turn left to 3,500 at Manchester DME 10. At 3,500 or above, continue turn left and proceed direct to Burnie. Number 2. To ensure separation from departing traffic on runway 23 left, aircraft carrying out the missed approach procedure should expedite the climb through 750 before commencing the right turn onto track 358. Number 3. Procedure turn is restricted to maximum 185 knots. Okay, grabbing the airdrome chart, runway 23 right is 3048 meters and 55 meters in width. After landing, we will vacate to the right as soon as possible. Rest of the taxi route we will deal with when landed. Okay, good, now we'll be in Top Cat. Landing will be at Manchester, runway 23 right. Conditions, we have winds at 1406 knots, temperatures 5, QNH 1007, and the runway condition is wet. Landing weight is expected to be 63.6 tons per the flap plan. Flaps will be 30, air conditioning on. NGIs will go on engines. Landing mode will be manual, and braking mode can be set to 2, as we have plenty of runway, and it's therefore unnecessary to tear in the brakes and make passengers uncomfortable with excessive braking. Computing those figures gives us a landing speed of 146 knots and an approach of 151. We'll use 2,242 meters off the runway, which leaves us with 806 meters to spare, which is within my comfort zone. Good, we'll jump back in the cockpit and enter all the figures we have gone through during the briefing. First, we'll check the transition altitude is programmed to 5,000 feet. Grabbing the CDU, descent page, forecast, and transition is 5,000, perfect. ILS frequency was 109.5, like that, and a final approach course of 233. Setting that in the first officer's radios as well. 233. And a frequency of 109.5. Switching that to the active and doing that for mine as well. Good indication that both radios is set up correctly is to see the HES prepare for our IMC approach category 3 landing. Minimums will set the barometric altitude of 331 feet. As we are closing in on the top of the descent point, we'll just allow the autopilot to begin its initial descent, setting the MCP altitude to 17,000 feet as we were expected to crest mullet at 5170. Autobrake goes to setting 2 and we'll enter the approach speed in the CDU. Landing flaps 30, FMC suggests a VREF of 146, which is the same as Top Cat calculated for us. Okay, that completes the descent preparations and we are now very well suited for today's arrival into Manchester. According to the plan, we'll be on the ground in approximately 20 minutes time, all depending on the amount of traffic we'll encounter during this arrival. For now, we'll just monitor the aircraft for a bit as we will transfer from cruising phase to the descent phase very shortly. We'll have to make sure that the plane actually begins its descent, that the autothrottle retired, not causing an overspeed, and all that good stuff. If we just have a quick look at the progress page, we see top descent is 2 nautical miles away, and the autopilot should make the transition any second now. When it does, the vertical path will be shown here at the right side in the ND, indicating whether we are above or below the calculated descent path. And there we go. Vertical speed is increasing and the thrust is decreasing, and we see retard mode in the FMA. That's just beautiful. Along with that, we have a FMC message, steep descent after mallet. That's A-OK, no worries there at all. It's only because we have not programmed the approach yet, which will give us plenty of time to bleed off this altitude. As we can see in the ND, the FMC believe that the route ends at Mercy and indicates the end of descent point there, which will of course change before we get that far. Okay, everything seemed good, which gives us a short surplus to check up on the fuel situation once again. At Lunas we had 3.0 tons of fuel, further planning we should have 3.1. So looking good, we are catching up even though we are still 0.1 tons behind. Arriving fuel is still on point with its 2.8 tons, but this could be because we haven't entered the approach yet, which gives us some more distance we will have to cover before we arrive. So let's do something about that, and actually contact Manchester Radar on frequency 118.57. Manchester Radar, Scandinavian 619, good evening sir. Checking in on the Mercy 1 Bravo arrival, descending through 51210.
Scandinavian 619, Manchester Radar, good evening to you. You can descend now for 70, be level at Mercy.
Down to 570, level at Mercy, Scandinavian 619. Okay, dialing the MCP altitude to 7000 feet. Like that. And we'll program the FMC to cross Mercy at 570. Whoops. Okay, let's try slash flight level 070. There we go. Execute. And we can now delete the expected altitude at mallet. Okay, that gives a FMC warning. Descent path unachievable. Let's see about that. Extending the speed brakes to create more drag. Very nice wing view here as we are about to come over the west coast of England. In the ND, we see the descent path is 2300 feet below us, however this number is decreasing. Green arc here indicates when we'll be at 7000 feet if we keep this rate of descent, which we won't because we must slow down to 250 knots by Wallisley VOR or if we descend beneath flight 100. Before we get much lower, as well as encountering these turns on the arrival route, we'll get our passenger strapped in, preparing for landing, which is about 15 minutes away. Okay, look like we are coming in on descent path. Regarding traffic, I only see two other planes in the ND, but more can easily come, as the TCAS only display planes within 40 nautical miles. One thing we'll do now is to program the approach, which could have been done a long time ago. Don't quite know why I didn't, but oh well, it's not a big deal. Execute. Checking the legs page, capturing at 3500 feet to the runway. If we go missed, straight ahead till 750 feet, then a right to a heading of 358 degrees. Perfect. So, coming through 13,000 feet, executing the descent checklist. Pressurization is set, landing altitude 250 feet. Recoil is clear. Autobrake is in 2. Landing data, we'll just grab the PFD here. VRF is 146 knots, minimums is 331 barometric. Approach briefing has been completed. Descent checklist complete.
EZ-4489,
stop descent, flight level 110. Stop descent, flight level 110, EZ-4489. So, we are just about to intercept the glide path as indicated in the ND. Now pitching to follow the new glide path. Speed is coming down as the throttles stay in idle. Speed bug goes to 250 knots as we are about to cross Wallisley VOR.
028 Alpha, descend to altitude 4000 feet, gun 1007.
Good, speed is coming down and we are back at glide path. Speed brakes can therefore be lowered once again. Pre-setting the pressure to 1007, preparing to be cleared below the flight levels. Okay, about to descend through 10,000 feet here, performing the 10,000 feet descent flow, which looks pretty much identical to the 10,000 feet climb flow, just doing the reciprocal. So, landing lights, runway turnoffs, logo and wings all goes to on, starter goes into continuous.
Scandinavian 619, flight radar heading 090 degrees.
Right heading 090, Scandinavian 619. Dialing that in. Activating the heading select and jumping back to the overhead. Notifying the attendants that we are about to land shortly, checking that the seatbelt signs are in the on position, pack complete is good, looking to see the cabin is depressurizing properly, again, cabin altitude should be at 1000 and the differential at 4. Seems good. 10,000 feet descent flow has been completed.
Easy 4489, descent for level 70.
Descent flight level 70, easy 4489.
Now following a heading of 090, which leads us directly to the ILS capture point. Just running through everything, checking that we have not missed anything. Cross-checking the ILS identifier, India Mike Mike. And the chart actually told us the identifier was India November November. Not too sure if this is a bug in prepare or on the chart, but I've flown this approach countless times before and it all works out perfectly, so we should be good. Okay, coming through 8,000 feet here, speed is a bit low, but the throttles are responding. As we have left the arrival route and are now being vectored, we can override the emergency waypoint of the legs page and set the ILS capture fix as our next. Now that we have come a bit closer to Manchester, we see another 3-4 planes about to land, but it shouldn't delay the arrival too much. Straight ahead, we have a good layer of clouds and temperatures are still below 10 degrees, which is why we'll turn on the engine anti ice once again. Even though ice probably won't form at temperatures of 8 degrees, it is always better to be safe than sorry. We do not know the actual condition in the clouds themselves, and huge temperature variation can occur. Weather radar shows nothing at this time, so we should be good to turn that off and enable the terrain feature instead, which comes in handy during approach. Especially here at Manchester, as we have some pretty serious terrain just east of the field.
Scandinavian 619, descent to altitude 3,500 feet, QNH 1007.
Continue descent 3,500 feet, QNH 1007, Scandinavian 619. And according to the FMC calculations, we are way below the descent path, but I'll just manually override this and do a vertical speed of 850 feet per minute to be a bit ahead of the aircraft and to come in for a controlled landing. Speed can come a bit down as well. 20 nautical miles left to the ILS interception point, where I wish to be in a stable flaps 5 configuration. As we are clear below flight levels, we'll just switch the barometer to the local pressure of 1007 hectopascals. Executing the approach checklist, altimeter is set 1007. Approach checklist has been completed.
All stations, Manchester radar is now closing. There's no further ATC available, unfortunately, so Montunicom 122.8. Bye-bye.
Unfortunately, Manchester radar has chosen to leave our lovely company, and we have therefore tuned in on the Unicom frequency instead. At this time, we have descended down to 3,500 feet and have self-vectored us on this kind of right downward leg. Flaps are in transit, moving towards setting 1, and the speed bug has been set for flaps 1 maneuvering speed. So, let's turn base, which is on a heading of approximately 140 degrees. Flap setting goes to 5, along with the speed bug to the flaps 5 maneuvering speed. For now, we'll just maintain this profile until we capture the glide slope, where we'll call for gear down and flaps 15. Turning a bit right to obtain a good interception angle. Arming the localizer. Heading can go a bit further. View all localizer is written in white in the FMA, indicating that it is armed and will automatically capture once we intercept. DME to the ILS is 12 nautical miles and we should capture the glide slope at 10 DME and 3500 feet, so we'll just stay at this altitude. Localizer has been captured. Arming the glide slope, letting it capture once we intercept. There we go, glide slope has been captured. Gear is coming down and setting the flaps to 15. Speed buck moves along to flaps 15 maneuvering speed. Okay, we have the field inside and we'll prepare for landing. Arming the speed brakes, the taxi lights to on. Assume we got the landing clearance. Okay, good, let's execute the landing checklist. Engine start switches are both in continuous. Speed brake is armed. Landing gear is down, 3 green. And flaps, they are still in 15, just changing that to flaps 30. Disconnecting the autothrottle, giving me full control of the thrust. Autopilot will disconnect that as well just shortly. Flaps are now on 30 and we have a green light, which completes the landing checklist. Autopilot goes off, I have control. Speeds are a bit high, reducing the thrust just a notch. Making tiny corrections here to stay in the localizer as well as the glide path. Speed now looking good, advancing the thrust to maintain this approach speed of 151 knots. Seems pretty stable. Closing in on the decision altitude. Just alternating between the instruments and the visual reference out the window. Continue. Thrust to idle, gentle flare, and we are down. Keeping back pressure on the yoke, avoiding slamming the nose wheel into the ground. Setting idle reverse. Reverse are green. Eighty knots. Out of reverse before we reach 60 knots. Lowering the speed brakes, flaps up, disarming the auto brake, and we'll let it roll for the next exit on the right. So we'll just vacate here. Slightly advancing the thrust. And once we are on the other side of the hold short line, we'll do the after landing flow. So just coming to a hold here, switching off the landing lights and the turnoffs. Starters go to off and switching off the strobes as well. Engine and GRs can come off, window heat is no longer needed, neither is the probe heat. Setting the transponder to standby and we are good to go. Master caution has been triggered because the probe heat has been turned off, which is a non-normal configuration, but no worries, we are well aware, and it's therefore a normal indication. Okay, we'll just complete the rest of this taxi in a fast forward mode, not to bore you, as I know this has been quite a long episode, but I'm very glad to see that you're still hanging in to the very end. Okay, we are now coming near the gate, it's just off to the right here. Turning off the taxi lights, not to blind the ground crew. Once we are perpendicular to the gate, we'll just make a sharp turn and hopefully line up bang center. When parked at the gate, we'll execute today's very last flow, being the engine shutdown flow. Yeah, we could have gone a bit further there before turning, but not a big deal. Thruster set, just a tiny notch above idle, using the brakes to control these very low speeds. And let's hold here, setting the parking brake, grabbing the CDU, FS actions, ground connections, setting the chucks, and connecting the ground power and the air conditioning card. Jumping to the overhead, ground power available has illuminated, checking the electrical panel, frequency and voltage looks good and it takes a load, meaning we can kill the engines now by putting both levers to the cutoff position. Passengers can be released from the seats and we can turn off the anti-collision light now that the engines has been shut down. Requesting deboarding from GSX. Opening both cargo hatches and the left front and aft entry. Okay, that's always the main priority, to shut down the engines, allowing the eager passengers to get off. However, there is a bit more to the flow. Fuel pumps all to off, electric pumps for the A and B hydraulic system both to off, depressurizing the system as the engine driven pump of course does not supply any pressure because they are off. Trim air goes to off, recirculation fans can come off as well because we have chosen to connect the air card. Both packs to off, isolation valve to open, and bleeds look good. Turning on some light here in the cockpit and we'll just clean up all the displays for the next crew. Just dialing zeros in all the displays, like that, and setting zeros in the transponder as well. And we are ready to execute the very last checklist, being the shutdown checklist. Fuel pumps, they are all off. Probe heat, all off as well. Hydraulic panel is set, both electrical pumps is off. Flaps are up, no light. Parking brake is set. Engine start levers are both in the cutoff position, and weather radar is off. Shutdown checklist has been completed. What a lovely ride today. Thank you everyone so much for staying with me on board through this entire flight. It has been a true honor having you on board. If you enjoyed, please don't hesitate to hit that juicy like button, as this has definitely been the most extensive episode I've ever made, and hours upon hours have been put into this for you guys. And if you don't want to miss out on further tours or any VATSIM emergencies, please remember to hit that subscribe button and I'll see you in the next video.